Well, I can't believe we've actually made it all the way to exercise 15 already. This is an exercise I call putting it all together, but this can help you analyze stuff in your own projects when you have to do them by yourself. So that's why this type of exercise I think is really, really important. So let's take a look at the first section of this, which is how do I decide what to put on my screen to track?
And as ever, let us take a look at our starting footage. So this is what we're going to be working on for the next few exercises. We have a screen replace, which is a bit more difficult than any of the other replacements that we've done up till this point. And in fact, this is a very challenging shot, even though at first glance, it looks like it should be relatively straightforward. This means we're going to have to put into practice a lot of the skills we've learnt up till this point, but we're also going to look at a lot of advanced techniques that we haven't checked out previously. Now, the reason that you might be fooled into thinking that this is going to be an easy track is we have a very clear image to start tracking from. So we have this phone screen, which looks very trackable. And on the screen itself, which isn't just a plain green screen, we also have lots of symbols and shapes, which are designed to make tracking a lot easier. Now, why are we adding this complication into our post-production? Why can't we just track the phone itself? I mean, this can't be more difficult than some of the stuff we've done in previous exercises. Well, unfortunately it is, because this phone isn't just a straight on screen. We have a nice curved edge around there. And this curved edge adds a lot of problems for us when we're tracking. Because all of a sudden, this planar shape suddenly isn't that planar anymore. So this object stops being a nice series of easy planes, front, side, bottom, top, and we have these weird in-between stages that are really going to make us work hard to track them. Okay, so we can't just track the outside of the phone here because that's not going to give us a true idea about what's happening. How about just tracking the screen itself? Well, let's take a look. We actually have a few things working against us there as well. Not only do we have a curved screen that's going to make it tricky to just do a straightforward track on it, we have a whole bunch of glare happening at the beginning of the shot, and we have a little bit at the end of the shot as well there. A little bit of reflection in the screen there. I'm just going to pop over to my other comp here, and we've seen these clips in the intros previously. And I've got actually a couple of different ones to show you. Let's just take a look at the first shot here. Just a couple of seconds, and this should cause us no problems whatsoever. In fact, if I turn on my screen replace, we can see I've got a good result in there. And if I've opened up my Mocha, you'll see that I've just got a simple, straightforward track happening. So nothing that we haven't seen before. This tracks well with the default settings. The only thing I've had to do is cut out a little area for the thumb here. And the reason for that is because the thumb drops off as we let go of the tablet. There we go. But this was an easy track. This tracked in first time. So really nothing of import to say there. Now, if we look at a similar track that we've seen, what's the difference between this track and the last track? Well, the difference between this track and the last track is we have a huge amount of glare. And this glare is amazingly effective at throwing off the tracker. So if we're not careful, we're going to have a very hard time getting a decent track out of this. Now, in this case, I did get a pretty decent track out of it. You can see that's holding steady very nicely. Forget about the fingers. You know, we can fix the fingers just by adding a mask. It's not like we spent a few exercises looking at masking or anything, you know. So, you know, forget about the fingers. Let's just look at the track itself for now. And that's cool. But of course, the glare gives us another problem. If we don't match that glare, then the screen replace looks out of place. Luckily, we can add the glare in fairly simply, and that helps to set everything into place. Let's take a look at how this was done. And as you can see, so if we pop into Mocha, as you can see, this is a little bit trickier than we had before. I've actually built this up over three different stages. So we've got the original track, And the original track, if I just turn on the grid lines here, the original track looks all right, but it does fall away a little bit. It sort of wobbles about a bit. So we've taken that track and we've adjusted it up a little bit to make everything a lot smoother. And then the final layer I've got here is actually just the, it's just the same as the other layer. I've just brought the surface in so that it matches up the screen and doesn't just extend all the way over to the edge. So we just get the screen in the screen replace. So even though you don't know exactly what I've done there, you can already see that factoring in for glare is going to add in another area of complexity that we didn't have before. Now, the only way I was able to track in this screen with all that glare that was happening was by having a nice, consistent edge. And I was using just the edge to track that in. Now, how does that relate to our main shot here? Well, with our main shot, we don't have that nice, steady edge. What we've got is this curved edge with its curved geometry that's going to be very difficult for us to track. So on this type of flat screen, not putting anything on the screen is a perfectly valid option when you're filming it, because we've got a lot of other planar data that we can draw on to figure out where the edges of this actual screen is going to be. When we've got something that's curvy, we're actually going to have something that defines our plane for us. Otherwise, we have zero chance of getting a track out of this shot. And the only option we'd be left with would be to manually come in and fix this. Doesn't sound nice, does it? So the upshot of this exercise is to answer the question that people ask me, what would you prefer we put in the screen when we're filming it if you're going to have to do a screen replace? And of course, the answer is, it depends. We've got a big flat screen here. We might not have to put anything in it. Maybe just a flat grey colour so we can easily figure out where the screen is and still pick up the reflections. If we have a lot of stuff moving over it though, say for example we had another hand coming in pointing at lots of different things on the screen and we don't fancy rotoing out that hand all the time, then having a green screen here would help us out, because instead of having to do roto on the hand, we could just key the screen. Of course, we'd still have to deal with things like spill suppression, but obviously that would just be a straightforward thing we'd have to do with any kind of keying. If we had something just like this, I wouldn't want a green screen in there. I could just happily roto those three fingers out because they're not really doing very much anyway. So wouldn't take a moment just to roto those out. But in the case of an object like this, where we have curved edges, we've got some nice fun lighting, without any extra help, we're never going to be able to create a shot that works like this. So here's our original. And here's what we're going to be ending up with at the end of the next few exercises. And we could even extend that idea out a little bit without any trouble whatsoever. So taking this from our wobbly phone, we're going to get a good track. We're going to get good rotoscoping. And we're going to be able to maintain some of that glint and glare and also maybe add a little bit more for ourselves. So this exercise was a little bit different than any of the other ones we've done before, because we haven't really been looking too much at the software itself. We've more been talking about the problems that we're going to be facing and trying to head them off before they become huge problems. And this type of analysis is going to save you hours, maybe days, sometimes on certain projects. In the next exercise, we are going to grab the bull by the horns and start to track this screen, which is naturally going to lead to the question, what do I do when my object doesn't track? And it's going to be a fun one. So I will see you in exercise 16.